set aside, but this social, economic, political trend is creating new boundaries between the migrants and the locals. I remember my students asking me, or my friends asking me, Father, are you not worried that there are so many Koreans in the Philippines? I said, no. And they said, why are you not worried? Well, if there are many Koreans in the Philippines, there are more Filipinos in Korea, and some of them are illegal. What is the point? We are not ready to welcome foreigners. Behind our mind is the idea that all the Filipinos have the right to migrate. Behind that is the idea that we have the monopoly of the privilege to do migration. Another mega trend that is changing Asia and the Philippines in particular is mega urbanization. According to statistics, the biggest cities in the world will be Asian cities. And in the cities, we also find a new border between the elites, the urbanized, and the urban poor. Poverty is flaring in the cities. And that is something for us to consider. The third mega trend is mega mediatization. This social trend is also causing the emergence of new borders between the computer literates and the computer illiterates. And if we look at this social trend called mediatization, we see the transformation of Asians from being Homo sapiens to Techno sapiens. I could see that immediately when I came here and watching you. We have become Techno sapiens. And what is the difference? A Homo sapiens is a thinking person. A Techno sapiens is a program person. The gadget is programming you, turning you or turning us into atoms. So atomization of human beings is taking place. Over and above all, globalization is changing Asia. So what is globalization? There are many definitions of the term. Allow me to propose to you a general one, and that is the compression of time, space, and knowledge, or awareness. In a globalized world, we see the motto, being put into practice, and that is more, better, faster. Globalization is creating the culture of consumerism. Just think of the times that you have changed your cell phones. You want to change more and more and more. Better. Better means the gadgets that we buy, the products that we buy, have lifespan. In the past, when you bought a car, you ask for the horsepower. How strong is that? Today, when you buy something, you ask, how long will this last? They say that if it is made in China, you use it only once and throw it away and buy another one. Faster. Today, the word instant is real. Instant coffee, instant noodles, instant boyfriend, instant girlfriend, instant everything in life. So the new Asia is being affected by globalization. And coming into Asia is the phenomenon called secularization. What is secularization? If you read the statistics given to us by Bishop Dominic yesterday, or Francis yesterday, you could see that the number of start going down, going down. By 2015, the biggest number of people in the world will be Muslims, followed by Buddhists, and followed by Pentecostal Christians. That is a scary information. So secularization means we dethrone religion, we dethrone God, and enthrone knowledge, particularly in science and technology. So this is the two Asia that I would read and present to you. The traditional Asia and the postmodern Asia. The traditional Asia is, as we know, the home of many traditions. And the modern or postmodern Asia is the home of many scientific, technological innovations. And from a distance, we could see that there is a creative tension, if you want, or there is a clash of two Asians. One, going to what they call in France, raison simon, and the other one, aggiornamento. Back to traditions, updating. That is Asia today, including the Philippines in particular. So Asia is changing. Because Asia is changing, there are many issues that are coming up. First is the celebration of particularity and otherness. I was very happy when Bishop gave his keynote address yesterday. He was emphasizing today that we must consider the other as significant as we are if we are going to engage ourselves in dialogue. The other is now written out in big O, capital O, signaling the new era that we must stop honoring the others because they are equally significant as we are. Philosophically, we could go back to Martin Buber, Levinas, and George Gadamer. Martin Buber says, relationships are very important. Sure enough, relationships are very important in dialogue. Levinas would say, the other is important. Just as you are important, the other is important. Then comes Georg Gadamer. We dialogue, and when we dialogue, there is a fusion of meaning, fusion of relationships, fusion of significance. The main point there is the word fusion. And David Tracy, a systematic theologian from Chicago, adds something more to that, and that is the cross-fertilization. Where there is fusion and cross-fertilization of meanings, of significance, and so on, and so forth. Dialogue is not easy. It is very difficult because it has many demands. The first demand of dialogue is change of mindset. From that of being very exclusivist to that who is more inclusivist and eventually pluralized. Before I went to school for further education, my mind was very exclusivist. Why? Because that's the way I was born. But when I studied in the university, the transformation gradually began. From having a mindset that is exclusivist, to that of someone who is inclusivist. Meaning to say, there are other peoples in the world. There are other cultures in the world. There are other languages in the world. There are other religious traditions in the world. There are other spiritualities in the world, and so on and so forth. The key word is the other. And when I was sent as a missionary to Oceania, I also had undergone a further transformation, and that is from exclusivist to inclusivist, and gradually to that of a mindset, or to that of a person having a mindset that is pluralist. In dialogue, we have to consider the risks and the challenges. And that is not easy because of the demands. The second demand is to re-image our image as visionaries, as atheists, or as visionaries. In the past, visionaries came to change us by teaching us their cultures, their languages. Today, a visionary must learn the language of the people. I was a visionary for 16 years in the Pacific, and I had to learn three languages. It took me 9 years to learn Samoan language. Very difficult. Why was it very difficult? Because my mindset was heavily westernized. The subject is followed by the verb. The subject and the verb followed by the object. When I went to the Pacific, the object comes first, followed by the verb, and finally the subject, the verb, the noun. It was a big challenge for me. So, as a missionary today, we have to be listeners, we have to be learners. And I hope that as I am re-imaging the image of a missionary, you are also thinking of the implications of these paradigm shifts in Philippine atheists. So, change of mindset, change of the image. Image number one, we must be more of a listener and learner, rather than a teacher and imposer. I thought that I was well prepared to go to the mission. I had my license, I had my doctorate. And when I went to the Pacific, things slowly collapsed and changed. I saw a picture, a big painting, in one of the churches in the Kingdom of Tonga. And it was a mural, actually. The Pacific Ocean was the motif. There was a missionary going to the islands. He was sitting down, and in front of him and behind him were the locals paddling the canoe. And in the midst of the people waiting for the missionary was Jesus Christ. That has changed my missionology. We do not bring Christ. Christ is there waiting for us. And therefore the challenge is to discover the images of Christ, Jesus Christ, in the cultures, religions, and spiritualities of people. The third image that I would like to propose is that of a reconciler. Do not forget that mission was a violent word in the 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th century. It was a violent word in the sense that we were Europeanized and we were Christianized. By doing that, the missionaries had to step on many elements, good elements of our cultures and our traditional religions. Today, the word superstition is taboo in missiology. In place of the word superstition, a new term is introduced. Indigenous spirituality or indigenous religiosity. And the word pagan is equally taboo today. All of us are pagans if we know the original meaning of the word paganus. A paganus is one who is outside of Europe. And so we Asians are all patriots in the eyes, in the minds, and in the hearts of the Europeans who came not only to Christianize us, but also to colonize us, or to colonize us and then to Christianize us. The fourth image that I propose is that a missionary must be a caretaker of God's oikos, meaning to say, of the world. A missionary must be an environmentalist. If ever there is one thing I appreciate very much from my experience as a missionary abroad, is care for the earth. The Pacific Islanders have taught me to love the earth because of their indigenous belief that the earth is God's temple, that the earth is our mother, that the earth is God's oikos. When I came back from the Philippines, every weekend I went home to Malaysia. What did I do back home? I started planting trees. I started planting many things. And people were wondering, why is Father Edna planting bamboos, planting mangoes, planting mahogany trees? I was homesick for the Pacific. And to cope with that, I started planting trees. I started becoming an environmentalist. Or, if I don't even like the word, I became more a caring person for the environment. Finally, the image that I propose is that of a mystic. I was very happy yesterday when the word spirituality was mentioned. In the 60s, 70s, 80s, we were all very active, crying for justice and peace. I grew up in that age where activism was very strong. In missiology, we used the term prophetic dialogue. We were prophets at that time. Today, in the 21st century, the other side of that is mysticism. And so, today, there's also the meaning to be mystical, to be a man or woman of silence, to be contemplatives in a noisy world. Silence is the language of God, and it is in silence that we enter into the mystery of God. Mission is entering into the mystery of God's love for peoples and the world or the environment. So the point now is, what are the tripods of dialogue? The tripods of dialogue, according to the FABC visions, are the following: culture, religions, and the poor. If you do not mind, I will include the fourth one, and that is ecology. Why is culture very important today? Culture is very important because the church wants us to express ourselves, our faith, our beliefs in God, in our own ways, in our own tongues, in our own mindsets. That is very clear when we study in culturation. But enculturation leads us to interculturation, or interculturality. The world today is changing. It is becoming more and more an intercultural world. And it is not easy to live life ignoring interculturality or multiculturality. The second tribal is religions. Asians are great believers in love. And because they are great believers in love, religion has become even more prominent today. Sociologists of religions predict that in the 21st century, religion will die a natural death. Before the end of the last century, the same sociologists of religion apologized to the world because they realized that religion will never, ever die. Because if religion dies, then cultures die. Religion is the heart of culture. And if the heart of culture dies a natural death, then culture will also die. The third is the poor. Why are the poor very important tribal of time? We have to understand that the poor are God's favorites. And because they are God's favorites, the idea of dialogue with the poor is to make them the subjects and not the objects of their destiny. I teach in the University of Santo Tomas, and I have a friend in Pinoval Street. He's a beggar boy. He doesn't know that I'm a priest. I guess he knows I am teaching in the university. To make a long story short, we have become friends. There was something in him that attracted me, and there was something in me that attracted him to me. And what is it that attracted me to him? I saw him begging religiously 3 times a day. 9 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 3 o'clock. In order to support his mother, a big woman who is an alcoholic. And I asked him, why are you begging? Why do you demand your mother so that she can drink more every day? Anyway, his answer is, my mother is very violent. If I do not give money to her, then I get the brunt of her anger 3 times a day. His name is Jerry. And one morning I said, Jerry, why don't you take a bath? You smell. Why don't you change your clothes, your t-shirt? I give you money while I'm buying you. His answer says, was this, sir, if I take a bath, and I changed my expression, I would not look like a beggar boy anymore. That made me realize that I talk a lot about poverty but do not know the world of the poor. And the challenge given to me is to enter the world of the poor so that I can dialogue with them. What was it that attracted him to me, made him attracted to me? It was his poverty. Because when I see a poor man, I see that I'm also a poor man. He served as a mirror to me, to be a poor man, to give the vow of poverty, so that I will be in solidarity with those who have nothing, just as I should be. So this would be the tribal dialogue. And the fourth one is ecology. Ecology, or the environment, is part of the salvific plan of God. 1 Timothy 2:4 says, God wants all to be saved. All means not only humanity, but the cosmos. And so the big challenge for all of us is to be at home in the cosmos. The cosmos is our home. It is God's temple, and it is the source of our life. We shall all become but the mountains will be there. We shall all be gone, but the rivers will be there. In Tagaytay, I enjoy very much my stay. Why? I like walking around. And as I walk around, I come to realize the beauty of God, the power of God.